face the prospect with a variety of attitudes.
Things you worry about most just never do come true. I can't imagine anything like that ever happening here. Besides, nobody would ever permit it to
use your idea, Nora.
Oh, I'm so sorry, of course. What's the bidding? Monica, these are the loveliest cards. They're so soft.
Time is not far off when, in case of war, the United States could be wiped out by a single atomic bomb. Unless adequate controls are adopted, the destruction of atomic war will be inevitable. Now, what does this mean to us? An entirely new way of life, an existence underground. It means moving our factories, our production centers.
There isn't going to be any war. Not the way we imagine it.
Oh, I don't know. I've been listening to that guy for some time now. You remember what he said about...
Wait a minute. You don't get my point. I mean, if there is a war, it'll all be over in a day or two. Inside a few hours, we'll all be dead.
I wonder. That's a pretty strong statement. I always thought that in a case...
I know. I have it on good authority. Very good authority, I assure you. I have some pretty important contacts down in Washington.
Still others face the atomic future with a constructive hope that peaceful ideals will ultimately prevail and that the nations will submit to international control of atomic energy. But until these peaceful ideals are realized, national security must depend upon immediate protective measures. The responsibility of preparing for atomic disaster rests in large part on the medical profession, both individually and collectively.
Even more than that, it's our business, and there's a very good reason for this. We, as doctors, are particularly qualified by training and experience to deal with disaster. Two world wars have taught us much. The handling of shock, blood banks, antibiotics, are all recent developments that have been stimulated, in part, by war. Expert medical care of the injured in recent civilian emergencies reflects our wartime experience.
But now, with the atomic bomb, we must once more revise our estimates, raise our sights, prepare to face disaster on an atomic scale. Yet there's nothing in our experience to prepare us for a catastrophe of the size and scope that may face us in the coming years. We have a population of about 250,000. Let's look at the problem in terms of our own locality. If we superimpose the known pattern of atomic destruction on the city, we get a very graphic idea of the scope of the damage and resulting casualty effect. It's not a pretty picture, nor one we can afford to ignore. At least 60% of the residential sections would be heavily damaged, with relatively moderate damage to the outer suburbs. Within a radius of about half a mile of the detonation, practically everything is destroyed. City government, transportation, communications, power and light.
The atomic bomb is primarily a weapon against cities, and particularly against cities of 250,000 inhabitants or more. In the United States, there are about 40 such cities.
Many, because of their size and strategic importance, might justify the expenditure of more than one bomb. Few of these cities are beyond the range of possible air attack. Against air attack, a strong and alert defense will intercept great numbers of the invading aircraft. But some may penetrate the defense. One plane, one bomb, one city.
I suppose the members of this group include every specialty in medicine, from pediatrics to geriatrics. But in atomic bombing, specialization becomes, for the moment, secondary. We'll all be treating a syndrome of burns, trauma, and radiation. Radiation, because of its novelty, has excited a great deal of interest. However, it is burns and trauma which will constitute, by far, the greatest medical problem. The number of casualties can be estimated with a fair degree of accuracy. Certainly, they will number in the scores of thousands. Now, active military defense is, of course, not our problem. It is our responsibility to prepare the necessary medical services in case of disaster. It's largely a matter of supply and personnel.
A single patient sustaining serious burns or trauma consumes a substantial amount of medical services and supplies. He may require surgical dressings, drugs, plasma, antibiotics, splints, whole blood. His treatment involves the services of doctors, nurses, technicians, and auxiliary personnel, not to mention a variety of medical equipment and facilities. 1,000 casualties occurring simultaneously would sorely tax the medical facilities of a large city. An atomic bombing could easily cause 100,000 casualties, at the same time greatly reducing the effectiveness of the local medical organization. The problem is greatly magnified by an environment of widespread destruction. The stricken city, paralyzed by disaster, is dependent for assistance upon surrounding communities. Mutual defense and assistance are essential. Each community, although prepared to exert a measure of self-help, must look to its neighbors for effective aid. Since the need is immediate, help must come from nearby. It follows that all communities within the stricken area must be mutually supporting, and that the overall area must be self-supporting and independent of outside assistance. Blood and plasma in immense quantities are essential to the treatment of burns, trauma, and radiation sickness. For this reason, entire populations must be blood typed and tagged in advance, instantly available in case of emergency. Technicians must be trained in venipuncture, transfusion techniques, and blood cross-matching. Universal donors particularly must be tested and tagged. As at present, whole blood cannot be stored for long periods, reserves of plasma must be increased 100 or 1,000-fold. Since no one locality can meet the blood requirements of atomic bombing, there must be a mobilization of whole blood on a wide regional basis. In an atomic bombing, adequate supplies of fresh blood will represent the difference between thousands of living and thousands of dead. Many laymen must be instructed in advance in simple blood count techniques as a method of estimating the degree of radiation injury. Classes must be established in first aid and the practical handling of casualties. Now is the time, when conditions are ideal, to train first aid workers so thoroughly that each of them will be able to meet any emergency with the calm resourcefulness of veterans.
Everybody ready? All out!
As a part of the same training program, local inhabitants must be instructed in convoy driving, not only for the evacuation of casualties, but also for transportation of essential medical supplies.
Oh, I was furious. You know, I was so mad I could have knocked her over with the proverbial fender.
It's your bed, Laura.
Oh, I keep forgetting you're supposed to have something horribly wrong with you. Well, here we go, kids.
Preventive medicine must not be neglected. With many burns and mechanical injuries expected, plus disorganization of hygiene and sanitation, normal immunization measures must be extended to cover tetanus, typhoid, and paratyphoid inoculation of children and adults. As in any community endeavor, publicity must play its full part. Medical relief measures must be based upon a vigorous campaign of public education. Educational exhibits, dramatizing the problems associated with atomic energy, have two important functions. For one, they enlist cooperation and participation in the work of planning and training. Even more important, they have the psychological effect of molding a sane, objective, and panic-free attitude toward atomic realities. This is Centerville, USA, a typical American city. This is Centerville, not next month, not next year, but some imaginary day in the atomic future. On this imaginary day, an enemy long-range bomber fights its way through our air defenses and approaches the city. An air defense radar station picks up the plane's image on the radar screen. A warning is radioed to the control point of the area. Immediately, the alarm goes out. Through a communications network, the surrounding communities are alerted. Condition red, attack expected. The weeks and months of rehearsal are ended. Now the lessons learned in exercises and mock drills are carried out in dead earnest. There is an orderly movement of all inhabitants to prepared and provisioned shelters. business and industrial activities cease in the expected target area. Against atomic bombing, appropriate shelters and adequate distance from the target are the best protection. In the bombed area, the uninjured helped the injured. At the instant of disaster, self-help and survival are synonymous. Without delay, all surrounding communities send their support toward the scene of the devastation. At well-stocked depots strategically placed in the suburbs of the bombed city, squads of first aid workers load their improvised ambulances with all the essentials of relief. Clothing, water, medicine, bandages, splints, stretchers, aid and succor for the wounded. The rescue squads follow thoroughfares which have been carefully chosen to give the best access to the city. The lifeline of supply and evacuation is established. When the debris of fallen buildings blocks the way, bulldozers smash through the obstacles. Ahead lies an area of utter destruction with thousands of men, women, and children in critical need of assistance. When vehicles can progress no further, rescue teams proceed on foot. Now the rescue squads, for the first time, face the terrible human wreckage of atomic bombing. Yet from the initial excitement and confusion, a pattern of order and efficiency will soon emerge as training and discipline exert their steadying influence. Reports are radioed back to the central control point to forecast the flow of casualties. Radio is the only reliable means of communication. The evacuation of the injured proceeds according to plan. At casualty collecting stations in the suburbs of the target city, well-trained personnel are ready to administer emergency care to successive waves of wounded. Stretcher cases, ambulatory cases, burns, fracture, loss of blood, the entire gamut of atomic injury. The work of medical relief progresses, directed from the main control point, purposely located in a protected site far outside the city. As in any battle, all information is recorded and evaluated on a master map of the area. Around the map, the strategy and tactics of relief are planned and activities in the field directed and synchronized. Throughout the disaster, evacuation of casualties continues to casualty collecting stations outside the bombed area. From their places of safekeeping, medical supplies pour into the devastated city. At the casualty collecting stations, patients are separated into three groups according to the severity of their injuries. In the first group are those with minor injuries.
Have his dressings examined, and as soon as he feels able, put him to work. We need every bit of help that we can get.
Minimum treatment and immediate discharge clears the way for more urgent cases. The second group includes those who are seriously injured and yet can be evacuated for intensive treatment.
Evacuate him immediately to the radiation center and have him kept under constant observation.
The third group is made up of those who are critically injured and who cannot be evacuated. For these, survival, if possible at all, depends upon emergency life-saving care on the spot.
Here. You better hold him here for observation. It may be a lethal dosage. Still, you can't always be sure.
The degree of radiation exposure is determined by the individual's position relative to the bomb center and by the protection afforded by solid material. After the casualties are examined, those who are seriously wounded and who can be moved are evacuated to special treatment centers nearby where specialized medical care can be administered. At the treatment centers, all available doctors, nurses, and medical personnel are at work handling the immediate needs of the injured, operating on surgical casualties, dressing burns and fractures, administering plasma and whole blood. Refugees and those discharged from treatment centers are directed to temporary shelters in surrounding communities. At the same time, public health is energetically protected. When infectious diseases break out, public health authorities establish rigid quarantines to reduce the spread of the disease. As a further public health measure, water, food, and sewage are kept under strictest control. Throughout the crisis, all activities are synchronized from the central control point. Only through centralized control, careful planning, and extensive preparation can personnel, supplies, and transportation be utilized efficiently in the interests of a stricken population.
Well, what do you think of our show? We're kind of proud of it.
Very interesting. You people must have put a great deal of work into it.
I can't understand where you find the time. My days are all so busy.
Here, you read this. I think you'll find you have the time, once you make up your mind. In fact, I think it's pretty interesting.
Oh. Well, all right. We'll read it.
Yeah, we'll give it the old voiceover.
Where do you learn all about this first aid business?
We have special courses every Monday and Wednesday afternoon at the high school.
How about evenings? All day I'm at the barbershop.
I don't make mistakes.
Oh, yeah? Remember what you told me about a war not lasting more than 24 hours? Well, mister, you're wrong. I ought to know. I've got important contacts, too.
We mustn't exaggerate the problem. Certainly, we must not minimize it.
The atomic bomb, however terrible, is not an absolute weapon. Its effectiveness can be materially reduced when employed against a population well prepared physically, psychologically, and medically. We, as doctors, have a great responsibility in carrying out these measures of preparedness. Our thought and planning will be reflected not only in the present welfare of the community, but in its capacity for survival. But one thing we must remember, all our efforts will be valueless unless based upon the wholehearted cooperation of the community authorities and the general public.
Thank you.
In the event of atomic war, the fate of any city will depend in large part upon the skill and knowledge of the entire medical profession, assisted by medical technicians in great numbers, directing their combined efforts towards full preparedness. The life of the community will also depend upon the energetic and far-sighted planning of community officials. But no single group or profession alone can cope effectively with problems of such size and complexity. Since atomic war is in a very special sense total war, it must evoke a total effort. Most important in this effort will be the full participation of the entire local population in a broad program of mutual protection.